Okay, so I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Jonathan Mandelbaum. He's a principal at Accelerator Life Science Partners, which assists in consulting on life science startups. Previously, he ran drug discovery groups at Millennium and Takeda Company.
Great. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Tony and the team, for the invitation to speak today. You know, 5-10 years ago, these sorts of events weren't going on in New York City, so we've come a long way. Here's an ecosystem, so thanks again, Charles River, for putting this together. I realize I'm the speaker before lunch, too, so I will try to be as expedient as possible. So I'll be introducing today Accelerator Life Science Partners, which in a nutshell we describe as an integrated turnkey venture capital model for catalyzing company creation in biotech. But before I go into the model, I thought it'd be just useful to take a step back first and from a macro level, just set the stage on where we are as an industry, in particular in the early stage biotech investing ecosystem, just to help frame, you know, why we believe Accelerator in the model is so important in early stage biotech. So firstly, as I'm sure everyone can appreciate in this room, it's an extremely exciting time to be working in this industry. Firstly, just simply from a fundamental perspective, FDA approvals of novel drugs over the past 10 years has been increasing steadily, such that 4 out of the past 5 years, we've had record numbers of new drugs being approved over the annual industry average of about 33. So clearly, from a fundamental perspective, industry is continuing to innovate in bringing novel medicines to patients, which ultimately is the end game here. And perhaps not surprisingly, the capital markets have been following along in this line over the past several years. Firstly, from the private side, healthcare venture capital dollars have been steadily on the rise over the past 10 years, with last year being a record year, almost $10 billion raised. And this has similarly trickled forward into the public markets, where at least you can see in terms of pre-money valuations of new biotech companies going public, that has also been steadily ticking up, especially over the past 2 years. Again, robust capital markets and fundamental improvements in terms of drug approvals. And so you would think, with this robust landscape and ecosystem, this would be trickling back to early stage biotech investing. And just from following the news, you would think that more and more companies are being formed and invested in by early stage venture capitalists. But in fact, the reality is much different. And I give credit to a partner at Atlas Venture, Bruce Booth, who is written about this extensively, and so I'm stealing a couple of his figures. But essentially, despite these strong market dynamics, company creation and early investing by venture capital firms has been relatively flat over the past decade. For example, on the left, you can see, just by looking at biopharma companies, the number of companies in a given year that are getting their first round of VC financings has been relatively stable. And this is in contrast to the tech space, where, again, what you would intuitively expect, there are more and more companies over the past several years that have been getting their first round of VC financing. And this has at least been in part likely constrained by simply the number of early stage venture investors. And that's quantified on the right, where if you characterize investors by the number of rounds that they're participating in a given year of either greater than 1 million, which sort of falls into the seed company creation phase, or 10 million, again, relatively consistent same number of investors investing in a given year. And so we believe that, at least in part, this venture creation bottleneck is due to the limited access and number of truly early stage venture capital investors, and secondly, which has been written about extensively, the ability of those investors to attract experienced management teams to run these companies at the earliest stages that are working on very nascent science. And so Accelerator was created back in 2001 in Seattle, really to try to integrate these key rate-limiting elements that we believe are necessary for starting new companies in a venture capital model. And so if you can put yourself in the position, we work closely mainly with academic institutions, so if you can put yourself in the position of an academic entrepreneur, if they want to start a company, they really need three main ingredients. They need access to early stage capital, a management team to help them run their company, and then potentially also facilities, lab space to actually do the experiments. An accelerator was formed really to put those three main ingredients under one roof in an integrated turnkey fashion. So in the next few slides, I'll introduce what exactly those capabilities are. So firstly, from a team perspective, this is the core accelerator team, which acts as the interim management across all of our portfolio companies. And we believe this is important, again, for the reason I mentioned before, as well as it's a capital efficient model. So for our investors, most of the money is going towards the actual science to push the research forward to the next inflection point. And related to that, again, the ability of venture investors to spend time to attract and recruit full management teams for each of their companies, especially when you're dealing with such nascent science, can be challenging. And so we act as the management team to really shepherd these early stage companies through the initial phases, de-risk the technology, and then at the right point, recruit management teams to take each company to the next step. So the senior management team for Accelerator, again, acts as the C-suite across our portfolio companies. They include Thong Li, our CEO, based in the Seattle office with a long track record and experience of investing in early stage biotech companies, chief financial officer in-house, and then a chief development officer, Ken Moeller, who has a pretty impressive pedigree from previous biotech successes. Alongside our team, we also have a roster of operating partners that are led by our chief operating partner, David Schubert. And these folks act as consultants for our investment opportunities as we're getting them off the ground and getting through diligence. And then also, once a company is formed, they can also sort of move in to help guide the companies and from a variety of different perspectives. So these folks come from biopharma R&D backgrounds, business development backgrounds, or from previous venture capital-backed companies with executive experience at fundraising. Additionally, we have a clinical and scientific advisory board in place, which again, we use as a sounding board when we're running new opportunities to ground to get their input and feedback, as well as when we start new companies, our portfolio companies are able to access the expertise from this board. And then lastly, we also have a group of senior advisors. Below are several different independent board members that we have on our board of directors, which again provide a different flavor of experience and insight from both the diligence side of things as well as strategic insights and executive oversight of our companies once we get them started. So that's the team. I mentioned also the capital. And so we've also created a syndicate of investors that invest in every single opportunity that passes muster. And I should say this is a true syndicate. So every one of these investors has to invest in the deal if we collectively get approval for that. And this includes a mix of both a traditional venture capital firms, such as the Alexandria Venture Investments and Arch Venture Partners, who have been two founding investors of Accelerator, a mix of strategic investors, which include AbbVie, Lilly, Pfizer, and J&J, contract research organization, and WuXi, and then here in New York, people are probably familiar with the Partnership Fund for New York City. And then lastly, facilities. As I mentioned, we have lab space through our longstanding partnership with Alexandria, lab space here in New York at the Alexandria Center over on the east side of town, historically in Seattle. And we've just recently expanded our footprint to San Diego as well. And so the access to lab space also cannot be underestimated. We can literally make an investment, start a new company in 1 month, and the next 1 to 2 months we can have scientists in the lab ordering equipment and running experiments. And so collectively between the lab capabilities, the management team, and the syndicate of investors, we really have this integrated solution for hopefully lowering the barrier to entry for early stage science, starting companies around them, and de-risking the technology at a much more rapid pace. So in the next few slides, I'll get into sort of how we go about thinking about making investments, some of our criteria, and then also just give a couple case studies, flavors of investments that we've done recently. So firstly, in terms of our investment process, it is relatively straightforward. We'll source deals from a variety of different mechanisms. And then the accelerator team will act as the initial triage mechanism to see, you know, if this is an opportunity that looks of the right flavor for us. We also have monthly calls with our several strategic investors in order to get a sense of whether a particular opportunity has at least some strategic alignment with some of those particular stakeholders, which is important to us. Though we have made exceptions, which I can get into if folks have questions on that. And then ultimately, if there's a sufficient consensus and excitement around the opportunity from all of our different stakeholders, then we'll run that opportunity ground and essentially see if we can create a compelling investment case for that deal. And then ultimately, our board will act as the investment committee and approve new investments. And then once we get approval, as you can see, we'll start a new company. And then the accelerator team, together with the board, will continue to provide executive oversight and operational support. And so we do this in parallel across a portfolio of companies with the ultimate goal of delivering return for our investors and hopefully also strategic returns for our pharmaceutical company partners. In terms of what we look for, we are predominantly focused on novel therapeutics, so biopharma and technology platforms that can help enable the discovery of new therapeutics. In terms of therapeutic areas, sort of broad strokes, we're interested in oncology, metabolic disease, neuroscience, and immunology, autoimmune disease. And we do invest very early. We can invest from concept to preclinical stage opportunities. And again, the technology does not need to be in the form of a company. We're often working with professors starting companies together with the tech transfer offices there. And then our investment structure is also very flexible. We can do seed investments, Series A investments, everything in between. And importantly, these are all milestone-driven projects. Our funding is almost always tranched to particular milestones and key inflection points in the program. And then companies should be housed at our accelerator facilities as well. So just to give you a flavor of kind of the filter, which again probably goes back to some of the earlier observations on sort of company creation and the constraining elements there. We've looked at over 3,000 early stage opportunities over the past 4 years, and we've made 8 investments. And so it's an extremely stringent filter for us. And of course, every early stage investor has different filters, and that's why having more investors in this space is healthy for the ecosystem. And so I'll go into a little more detail on kind of some examples of companies that we started. And a couple of case studies. So first, just a few highlights here at a high level. These are actually all companies that we started here in New York, so of relevance to this audience. One of our first investments was a company called Petra Pharma. This was a $48 million Series A investment back in January of 2016. where the company was based on some really exciting novel biology coming out of the labs of Lou Cantley of Weill Cornell and Nat Gray at the Dana-Farber. Additionally, another company we started around the same time called Lodo Therapeutics. This is a company that raised initially $17, now it's a $20 million Series A, based on the work from Sean Brady at Rockefeller University. I'll go into that company in a little more detail on the next slide, as well as Magnolia Neurosciences, our most recent investment in the neurodegeneration space, which again, I'll dive into a little bit afterwards. So firstly, Lodo Therapeutics. This is a company that initially was a technology platform that was being developed in the lab, in Sean Brady's lab at Rockefeller University, that was being funded for a few years by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation through grants. We got introduced to this technology through the Gates Foundation, actually a prior intern at Accelerator, now works at the Gates Foundation, so this is how some of these deals get done sometimes, and we got introduced to the technology, which is really a next generation approach to what pharma historically did back in the heyday of the sort of grind and find method, where they would take soil samples, try to uncover natural products from those soils, and a lot of those programs ended up being novel antibiotics, some cancer drugs as well. But Sean has really now leveraged sort of new technology that's been obviously developed over many years in bioinformatics and next generation sequencing and synthetic biology to really open up Pandora's box of a whole host of natural products that historically were not accessible through these grind and find methods. So there's a really broad and powerful platform technology that has applications in infectious disease, oncology, microbiome, et cetera. And so we were very compelled by the broad applicability of the platform. There also was a chief scientific officer a co-founder became CSO of the company, initial CSO, David Pompliano, who brought a tremendous amount of background from Merck and GSK with an infectious disease background. And so it was a great technology, it was a great initial team. We were able to co-fund this together with the venture capital arm of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And so there was a lot of great reasons to do this deal, which we obviously did. And then excitingly, last year, we got some external commercial validation for this technology as the company did a big research collaboration with Genentech. So the company is continuing to operate and expanding. I think it's about 18 employees now at the Alexandria Center. So this is just one case study of a company that we've done. And I'll just briefly touch on one more company, our most recent one, which is really exciting and interesting because it's in the neurodegeneration space, very difficult area, but of course a huge amount of unmet need. This was a technology that came to us through MD Anderson, interestingly, of all institutions, thinking about a neurodegeneration program. And the founders, again, extremely strong pedigree with a mix of biotech and industry backgrounds. Jim Ray, one of the co-founders, formerly from Takeda and Envoy Therapeutics. And then Phil Jones, a medicinal chemist with a tremendous amount of experience from his days at Merck. They were working on a novel area of biology, drug discovery program applicable for neurodegeneration that's importantly non-amyloid, non-tau-based, which is really sort of a space that pharma is really keen on diversifying their pipeline in trying to tackle neurodegenerative diseases. So not surprisingly, there was a lot of competition for this deal as well. We are able to win it and secure the deal, license the IP, form the company, and then made a $31 million Series A investment. Now what's additionally unique and interesting from an investment perspective on this deal is that the founders had come up with a very clever clinical development strategy for rapid proof of concept in an indication that is not Alzheimer's disease, which we know is a long slog. And so from an investor perspective, actually, the sooner you can sort of get to that critical yes, no, is this working in the clinic, the more attractive the opportunity looks like. And so because of that interesting clinical development strategy, we were able to leverage a cancer-focused Texas-based grant funding agency called CPRIT, which has a tremendous amount of money. It's always bigger in Texas, I guess. And we were able to leverage our investor dollars with $20 million of non-dilutive funding from CPRIT. So I believe that is all. I might have sped through my talk, but this is just sort of a snapshot of all the portfolio companies that we've started over the past 15 years. We're in this to do well by doing good, and with the ultimate goal, of course, of trying to create high-impact medicines for patients. So thank you again for your time, and happy to take any questions. Everyone's hungry.
So I wonder, when you mentioned all these really, very accomplished investigators, that the biology came out from their labs. Did you have any young investigators' interest, or did you pay attention to any of the young investigators coming out of the academic labs?
Yes, for sure. So we've definitely started companies with young investigators, however you want to define young.
assistant associate. I mean, Luke Antley is a very prominent figure in cell signaling, but someone who's not the caliber of Luke Antley, for instance, or in first 5 years of their labs.
So I don't know about first 5 years, but Sean Brady, for example, when we invested in him, he wasn't a tenured professor at Rockefeller. He was an assistant professor, so. I consider Sean a young, tenacious, entrepreneurial, but relatively unproven from a sort of a biotech startup perspective. That is one example for you. So we certainly do not take that lens, though I have to say that sort of part of the equation can come into certain investors and part of their formula, how they make decisions, but not exclusively. We need a full team, not just the academic, but of course from the industry side as well, to really make sure that we can take a technology from that academic's lab and make something of it.
Hey, Jonathan. Can you say a little bit more about the kinds of criteria that you use to evaluate whether or not you want, like for an academic, finding whether or not you want to start a company? Is it novelty? Is it obviously the financial gain potentially is part of it, but some of the other things that you use to consider?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I really liked some of those quotes that Bill had up in his slide, which are very sort of generic responses and rebuttals when you're dealing with very novel biology or novel drug target, because it's true. It's not proven, and so although we do gravitate towards, and I think part of our criteria is really an opportunity that has a chance to be a first-in-class medicine. There is sort of a yin and yang of how early from a sort of de-risking side that technology is at when we're looking at it, but certainly novelty, first-in-class. As I mentioned, allude to some strategic alignment is important for us in terms of getting proof of concept, which will ultimately catalyze either a Series B financing or potentially a pharmaceutical partnership, ultimately an exit. The clinical. I was alluding to clinical development for Magnolia. Some of these bigger disease areas where you need to get to a late stage clinical endpoint to ultimately prove your hypothesis can be challenging from an investment perspective, just because that's going to be ultimately that may be the rebuttal you get from every pharma partner you talk to when you're trying to partner a program, and similarly venture investors may not have the appetite to fund something so long. So the indication needs to be really well thought out as well.
Hi, Jonathan. This is Jolly. And I was wondering if you could once again define what you call early stage, because you know, as a new company, we hear different definition. And I know Accelerator, you mentioned it has a very stringent process, only 8 out of 3,000 or whatever applicants. But what's Accelerator in general? You know, what's the definition for early stage?
Mm-hmm. So early stage for us is anything in the preclinical process, which again is from concept to something that's in, you know, late lead optimization that may be, you know, 12 months from IND enabling studies, for example. And you know, we've done deals very early, we've done deals much later, and there's a whole host of other factors that kind of get it into you know, how early, you know, we will go on some opportunities. But just to give you a flavor, you know, we theoretically can do and have done everything in that part of the process.
Thanks so much. You mentioned the diseases that you were interested in. Are there diseases that you are not likely to support, and could you rationalize why?
Well, the easiest explanation, and the real one really is some indications we won't do, mainly because there is no strategic investor alignment in that area. So, for example, we were looking at something you know, a couple years ago in the ophthalmology space in dry eye. It was an interesting opportunity, but just simply none of our investors are in ophthalmology. So that is an element. I should say Loda Therapeutics is one of those companies that sort of broke the rule, because the initial, even though it's a platform company, the initial pipeline programs are in infectious disease. And so that it's sort of the platform promise and potential that got the investors excited enough, even though from a sort of a product development perspective, infectious disease was not really on thesis for them. We also did another company didn't mention here called Proneris, which is actually a really interesting biodefense play based on a repurposed asset out of Eli Lilly, where again the business case for that company is purely financial. There's no strategic component to that deal, so we have some flexibility, but we you know, our pharma partners wouldn't invest in us if we were just doing everything that wasn't on strategy for them. Thank you.